Welcome on this very special winter's morning here in the African bush to your live safari. Hello. Hello, little one. And that is where we are. We are here on Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains private game reserves in the Sabi sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. My name is Jamie and this morning Brian is on camera with me and of course the thumb making his usual morning smart appearance. Don't forget that we are also interactive. I think a little antelope just stumbled across the hyena den and got a surprise. When Mom stood up, there was just a disappearing dust cloud, and the pitter-patter accidentally wandered to the wrong termite mound. Definitely didn't sound like paws skittering away in the leaves. I think that was something else. And straight away, hyena cubs doing what they do instinctively, which is to disappear into the safety of their den site, into the safety of those tunnels there. Let's just give them a moment to relax again. I think I was in the middle of saying that you can send through questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. But as with any live safari named Gwen, by our viewers who keep very close track of the different hyenas of the hyena clan of Juma. And her little cubs are probably just over a month old at this point. There are two of them, although we started off with just one popping its head out of the den. And from what little we've seen of their behavior, it seems as though one is definitely bolder and slightly larger than the other. I have a feeling it might take Gwen's little cubs a bit longer to get used to the presence of vehicles. And that's because the rest of the cubs that we've been watching over the last few months, they've actually grown up with older cubs around them. Then they imitate their behavior, so the older cubs show them that it's okay to be relaxed around vehicles. Whereas I think with these little cubs, she's deliberately separated them from the rest of the clan, I think. Hyenas are by nature curious, very, very intelligent, and chances are they'll learn very rapidly that they don't need to be scared of us. Because Mom clearly isn't. Mom is not at all fazed by our presence here. Here we go. Females to lie upon. In fact, it is relatively uncomfortable. The Mvubu Road den had a nice flat spot where the females could lie. The Galago shortcut den, which is where we are now, doesn't quite have the same effect. Hopefully the little cubs will decide to come back out. So while we wait for them, let's go over to James, who is on foot on this brisk and chilly winter's morning. Let's find out what his plans are.
Hello, David.
Hello, Ben.
It's 8 degrees, apparently. That's pretty chilly. 47 degrees Fahrenheit for those of you living in the 18th century. And it's very nice to be on foot, actually, because we're warming up quite nice. It feels a bit warmer than yesterday. The first thing we found for you today is this thing, and it's called Mwampokoro. Can everyone say that? Mwampokoro. That's the Shangaan name for what is a bat. Herbert is on security detail. And he's just told me that this thing, well, A, is called Mwampokoro in Shangaan, and that if a cow eats it, so you can imagine a drought conditions like this, there are cattle all over the local areas here, walking past trees out here. If they eat one of these, they will die. I asked him if it would kill a person, and he looked at me as though I was mad and said, obviously, if it'll kill a cow, it'll kill a person. So I thought that was fairly good logic. Anyway, he's now moved off into the bushes there. And so that's a bagworm. Mwampokoro. Now, yesterday we had a few questioning. First of all, his main function is a security detail, and we can't have him. The reason we have a security detail now is that the presenter's face is looking at you, which is where it should be, as you look at me. And That means that I am not fully aware of what's going on around me all the time, and I have to be, or the security detail has to be. So that's one reason. The second reason is that he's still a little bit shy and getting used to security details. So that is the idea. So that's the plan. Our plan this morning is to head off towards the western side of the reserve. We're hopefully going to find some tracks. Watch out for that stick, David. If you stand on, if you sit on that, Dave, it might be. Well, you probably won't. We're not really sure we're going to find. There were some Karula tracks around there yesterday, so we'll see what we can find there, but it's basically a little voyage of discovery to see what we can see. We are as live as Jamie is, so hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. And so if you want to ask any questions about the local people or the local uses of plants and that sort of thing, please feel free to ask those. We're going to hand you back to Jamie, but I'm just going to show you a shortcut as well over the hyena den.
We are sitting here patiently waiting for the little hyena cubs to get brave again and to pop their heads out of the den site. Just waiting patiently. Might be that we have a long wait ahead of us, in which case we'll probably move on and search for other things, but I'm a great deal of time around the den site itself. As they get older, that will start to change because, as you know, with tiny little animals, with kittens or puppies and indeed hyena cubs, when they are that age, they need to feed more regularly than they will when they start to get older. So mom sticks around almost constantly, and only really every now and again when she's desperately hungry that she moves away and goes and off to find food before returning. Absolutely stunning morning. And a wonderful way to start. I still don't know what it was that disturbed them. Whatever it was, it didn't come back. I'm relatively convinced it was an antelope of some kind. Beautiful, crisp morning out here. Now, when we first saw the two cubs out properly together at this den site, there was a bit of squabbling going on between the two of them, actually some relatively serious squabbling that we saw. And of course hyena cubs fight, hyena siblings fight, they push each other, and while there's still a danger that one of Gwen's cubs will kill the other, and there are recorded cases of course of siblicide within hyena cub litters. What will often happen is if two females are born, then the one cub will kill the other one in a serious conflict for dominance. I think we're past that stage, first of all. I don't think there's much of a risk that that will happen. That being said, you never know, never say never. And that, in fact, the researchers of, or the authors of this particular article suggested that their opinion was most cubs were actually killed by anticide, being killed by other females in the clan, rather than by their own siblings, and that it was in fact a slight misconception that we have about hyena cubs. There's two or three articles that I've read that suggest something similar. But the thing about spotted hyenas is that we just don't know everything there is to know about them. Short of putting a nest cam into the den site itself to be able to see what goes on, and spending all of It's okay. At this age, they barely even look like hyenas at all. Oopsie. Thirsty. Want breakfast. Look at that. That's just a bird, little one. It's just a bird fluttering. It's okay. This is my favorite age to watch them at, when they're still mastering that is mom's shoulder blade. Oh, never mind, I'll settle for chewing on her ear instead. Now, blue butter frog, I haven't said anything about their names, so don't worry, you didn't miss anything. It's because we haven't named them yet. We found ourselves at a little bit of a crossroads here. Oh, bye-bye. Come on, bring your sibling up. next year or so, we'd be nicknaming the hyena cubs after the month that they were born in. We've encountered a hassle here, which is one that was relatively predictable due to the natural passage of time, but that is, we've now come full circle. We have a hyena cub that is now almost a hyena adult, sub-adult, called June, so we can't call these cubs June 1 and 2. We'll have to start coming up with it. Otherwise, it becomes completely impossible for us to actually keep track of their dynamics and their movements. Imagine if I was telling you that this was number 13, I don't know, number 12, and her two cubs, number 13 and number 14, and then they were interrupted by number 8, and number 8 is higher ranking, whatever number system we would give to them. It's next to impossible. Researchers do that as well. Okay, we're going to give it another few minutes, see if these cubs aren't brave enough to both pop their heads out. In the meantime, the sun is popping over the horizon.
Isn't that the most glorious sight, everybody? And of course, one of the difficulties of working out here is the earliness with which you have to get out of bed in the morning and that. But once you are used to it, how it's very difficult to actually get out of bed after sunrise anymore, because once you've seen that a few times, it's just the most beautiful thing in the world, and especially if you experience it here in the middle of the Kruger National Park, or the western fringes thereof, well, there's just no real something else for us here. It is the exoskeleton of a scorpion. Have a look here, David. There on the end of the log do not have a skeleton inside like the vertebrates. So mammals and fishes and amphibians and reptiles and birds, those are the five classes of vertebrates. They have got internal skeletons, so bones inside them. And the rest of animals, which include all the arachnids, which is one of these, and the room to grow. Your bones can grow inside your body, of course. This thing's exoskeleton cannot grow outside it. It's very difficult for it to expand inside because there's so many different parts. And so what they do is, instead of growing the exoskeleton, they just get another one. So once they're ready to grow, they eat away the front of the exoskeleton round about where my finger is sitting, and they crawl up around this current scorpion. Now this scorpion, I suspect, is quite a nasty fellow. He's got quite a thick tail, quite thin pincers. I don't know which species it is, but I suspect it's probably an olive bark scorpion. And an olive bark scorpion is going to do some serious, well, it won't kill you, but it'll certainly make you feel rather ill. And that's what this one is. And it's very, very fragile. It's made of something called chitin, and it's pretty much indigestible, in much the same way that your hair and your bones are indigestible. Now, Herbie's just hailed me and said that he's found something else. Continuous surprise. Come on, David. Just look over here. Herb basically walks around and he tosses these logs over and finds all sorts of magnificent things. You see him? And he'll be so cold at the moment, he'll be unable to move. We'll find it very difficult to move. Isn't that incredible?
You just move this leaf.
This one. There we go. That's the olive bark scorpion. Olive burrowing scorpion, or bark, I can't remember. Anyway, he's the olive one. You can see he's olive coloured. And that's exactly what we found. That's the exoskeleton that we found. I don't think it's the same scorpion, unless he's migrated some distance. Isn't that lovely? Now, Siberia Zumi, you say, are there any plants out here, or insects that are used for apothecary reasons? I think that's what you said. In other words, are there any plants out here, or not plants, are there any insects out here that are used in traditional medicine? Not many that I know of. There are one or two. I can hear some elephants shouting off towards the west of where we're standing now. That's in front of your screen. There is that one example that we found this year called the flea beetle that lives on a plant called Rusquenzii. And it's called a flea beetle because it jumps. It's a beetle that and for, well, I mean, if you wanted to kill someone, you could use it. You take the larva and it's very toxic, and you spread the guts over your arrow and you, bing, your arrow at an animal or at your enemy, and they will die a very horrible and painful death. And that's a pretty useful thing to use the flea beetle larva for, I find. David, don't ever do that to me. I shall be very upset. Come on, then. Bianca, you're in Australia and you're a new viewer, and it's wonderful to have you with us. Thank you for coming on our walk today. I had a physical job this. Bianca, you want to know about... I'm just listening for elephants here. They are just in here, so we must listen carefully. I'm going to talk a little bit more quietly. You want to know about how many times a scorpion will change its skin. I don't know for sure, but with most of these animals, most of these invertebrates, it's normally about 7 times that they do it. So they're born molts later. They become fully blown adults. So it's about 7 times, Bianca. Okay, now over here is a pile of white dung, which is very unpleasant, and the creature that made it, of course, is the creature that you're going to see now with Jamie.
Unfortunately, we have actually left our hyena for now, and the reason is I think that those cubs, but the fact that it is the temperature it is actually one of the reasons why I've left now. So most of you know that we've been treated to several amazing lion sightings over the last few days. And there is a rumor, supported by no small amount of fact, that there might be lion cubs hiding in a drainage line. And just on that subject, sorry, somebody wants to chat to me on the Game Drive channel. I think it might be Herbert. Standing by. So far, but I've went straight to Miska. Okay, just quickly checking whether or not we've found any leopard tracks to follow up on. But yes, there's rumours supported by fact that there are lion cubs hiding in the drainage line around Gowrie Cutline, which is supported by the fact that there was a male lion there yesterday. And I say that because I think the female that he was mating with, Amber Eyes from the Nkuhuma Pride, actually brought him back, as she was looking for a little bit of company of a female variety, not of the male variety. And we're going to go and check there because I'm hoping the drainage lines or the river systems are the coldest place you can go on a morning like this morning. And it is really cold. I mean, it's really very cold. I mean, freezing. Brian is wrapped up in several million layers, plus a blanket. I've got a hot water bottle in my jacket. It's quite chilly. And I'm hoping that it might sort of spark a desire in the female to take her cubs out of the drainage line and into a patch of sun somewhere on Gowrie, where they will be out and about very, very shortly. They're close to 6 weeks of age, or they must be about 5 weeks old now. So they will be moving around, and she will be bringing them out of their den site more and more frequently. Let us go and investigate. And it's an absolute pleasure. That, of course, is addressed to Anthony. Anthony, welcome, as always, to our sunrise safari. Anthony sent through a big thank you for Game Drive channel. It sounds as though they did find leopard tracks on Juma. Sorry, Anthony. It's an absolute pleasure to bring you the wonder of the African bush. It still amazes me that we are at the stage where technology has reached the point where we can do that, and I don't even begin to understand how it all works, but I am very glad that it does. And of course, we're very privileged to be able to spend as much time as we do in such a magical... I'm actually not going to go any faster. It's too cold. And to another new viewer, Wendy, another good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. We have left our hyena den for now, but I spoke in a little bit of detail about our hyena clan of Juma. From that, you want to know how many hyena clans we have on the reserve. And the answer is we don't actually know. I mean, where we are at the moment within the Sabi sand, we are open to the Krugan are absolutely enormous, it actually is. So I couldn't begin to tell you how many clans there are. I will tell you that we see one regularly, and that is the Juma clan, and we've been trying to understand... Sorry, Wendy, can I put your question on a back burner for one moment? Just because there's lion tracks everywhere. I'm going in towards Mvubu Road. Okay, it is a little bit early still. The sun's not really up enough for us to see them clearly. But our lions have been wandering about very regularly. It's a main road. And a lot of them are still visible even when the car tracks have gone over them. This is the direction our mail went in yesterday evening on the sunset safari. So I'm going to change my route plan and we're going to do a quick loop around the Vuba Road and then up Gauri Cutline. I'm not going to hop out right now to show you what we're looking at. We can do that at another time. The fact that they've been lying in the road is also interesting. There's a flattened patch where they've been lying in the road. So they've been around. I just want to check here whether or not the tracks go carry on east or if they go in towards Juma, south towards Juma. We're on our northernmost traversing boundary. Up, down, round and round. In. What I'm looking for, because I've now got tracks going in two directions, I'm looking for where they meet up and where one falls on top of the other. Wendy, I'm just going to concentrate a little bit on trying to figure out where our lions have gone. I will answer your questions when we come back through onto the back of Rusty. In the meantime, let's go over to James and see what his plans are on bushwalk.
Ugly because it's got the most beautiful smelling flower. That's the Gardenia volkensii. Now, Herbert's basically given me a 20-minute lesson on this tree, but the most interesting bit of it was that you take the bark like this. If you're a trainee sangoma, now sangoma is a traditional healer in this area, a herbalist normally, and also a spiritualist in many ways. What you do is you take the bark off, a little piece of the bark like, say, that, and probably a bit more than that, and you crush it up into a fine powder, then you put it in. Coming out at 90 degree angles, so you can see that there. You see the branchlets coming out at 90 degree angles from, or sort of pair, horizontally from the vertical branches. Now, because of that, it makes quite a good beater. So you take a piece, say, from my finger here to there, and you can see it's got a good beating stick on it, and you beat up the solution, and it eventually will foam. And then if you're a sangoma, to show respect, now Herbert, you must tell me if I get this wrong, what you do is you face away from the sun, so the sun is at your back, and you go, get on your knees, you put your hands behind you, cleansing your mind, so that you may take on the lessons that you need to for that day. And I just think that's a really wonderful story of this tree. I had no idea. I knew that it was quite important. I didn't know quite how important. And then the other thing he told me was you take these little branches like this, and if you want to ward off evil spirits from your home, is a great medicinal sort of, I'm trying to find a Western term to sort of to make it understandable. It's like an aspirin, I guess. It's got everything in it. It's a general purpose medicine. Because an elephant eats just about everything, there are all sorts of different medicines in it. So you take four pieces of elephant dung, you bury them at the four corners of your property, you pop that inside there, and these sharp points here harm you and your family. I think that's wonderful. And it's, I guess it must be, there must be quite a lot of ritual involved in it. And the rituals, I suppose, are what keep, well, they give you peace. I think they give you a certain sense of peace and comfort. I don't really know how else to describe it. Now, Jamie, of course, being what she is, highly skilled in the bush, has managed to find you some cat.
Here, but at least we picked the right direction, following the tracks. And look who we found. It seems as though Blondie was not as deserted as I initially thought. He's doing some territorial marking. And what a lovely surprise this is. A wonderful way to start off our morning safari. It's definitely Blondie. We watched him disappear last night into the darkness, and I said that I thought he was trying to find the rest of his coalition. He has been distracted by the presence of the who is looking longingly in the direction of her compatriot, another Nkuhuma Pride member who's been wandering about. She's actually trying to stay out of the way of the mating pair. She's moving right at the back there. I think she's actually going to disappear behind that termite mound. And that is probably the mother of those cubs. And the one thing that's immediately noticeable for all three of them is empty, empty bellies. These are hungry lions at this point. She wants to go and deep booming growls. Okay, we're going to, okay, let's do this way. I think we're going to have to just try to follow them. Tis what it is. It's going to be tricky. Oh, beautiful. That light is just stunning. We're going to stay with them because I think if I try and loop them, there's a chance we could lose them in this block. So everybody watch your heads. Ah, oh, not this place again. I've done this, been through this before. It's a very tricky spot. Yeah. Because this is where we followed them when they lost their kill to the hyenas. It's not an easy area. Watch out, Bebop. I'm gonna hit you. Where is that other lioness gone? Ooh, listen to this. She is not impressed with him. She wants to play. Hey boy, you're causing chaos here. You're upsetting the apple cart. Very confused. Very, very confused. Can't understand why his lady friend is so terribly unimpressed with his presence. Okie dokie, let's try this again. I'm hoping we're going to be able to keep up with them. Let's stay with them for as long as we can. They keep getting up and lying down, but they're not going to stay lying down. They're going to keep moving. They're hungry lionesses. And lion, but he's got a... That's not amber eyes at all. That is not the female that he was mating with. This is a different lioness. Oh, terribly interesting. As you can tell, there he goes, marking his territory. Though they glance across in our direction every now and again, our animals out here, despite being completely wild, are more than comfortable in the presence of the vehicles. Justin, are we ever afraid that they will get too comfortable? Ooh, she's cross. Too comfortable? No. Animals, and therefore unpredictable and potentially dangerous? Yes, absolutely. Especially a male lion that is courting a female and is often a little bit resentful of the presence of anything coming between him and his potential mating rights. We're always very, very cautious of that. There is a complacency that does occasionally strike out here. People get very used to the animals being very used to the vehicles, and they take it for granted, and they push things, and that's when accidents happen. Look at this. It's not amber eyes at all. Totally different in Kahuma female, and it's not the female with the cubs. Where is the other one gone? I've lost her completely. Oh, there she is. We'll have a look at her in a moment, but she's hidden for now. Hello, boy. Haven't you exhausted yourself with amber eyes? Are you really up for another 5-day session straight away? I'm most impressed. What I mean by that, of course, is he's just been mating with one of the other females, and it's not an easy process for a lion. It's a demanding one. For 3 or 4 times an hour for 5 days is a considerable period of time and a certain amount of mating. Blondie. I'll try and have a bit of a closer look at him. I think it is, though. All those scars across his face. Wonderful. The other lioness is hidden in front of us, but she's right behind a bush for now. I just wanted to try and see and try and work . We'll have to wait for our opportunity to do that. I don't think these lions are going to stay lying down. I think they're going to lead us on a mission through the block. I am, as I mentioned earlier, on the lookout for the female that is lactating. And the reason is I would very much like to find the den site where she's hiding her cubs for us to know. If it's in a good position, then we will be able to view them. If it's not, then of course we shan't, and we absolutely will not upset or push them in any way. Lucy in South Bend, Indiana, we were thinking, if not, actually, she'll probably be quite happy to keep them there. We've just spoken about how comfortable our animals are with our presence. Now, her den site on Torchwood was right on one of the main roads, which meant that the cubs were actually encountered several times during their time in that particular den site. Vehicles would come past, and all of a sudden there were lion cubs right there. So they'd stop, behave very respectfully at a suitable distance where they were and what was happening at that den site, and she stayed there for a good 2.5 or so weeks. So no, the presence of vehicles itself or people is not automatically going to cause the lioness to move her den site. What might is if there's, say, an incursion of strange young male lions, even if Junior and his buddy decided to come back and pay a visit, she might try and move them closer to wherever the Birmingham boys are, because for all intents and purposes, they are the fathers of the next generation of cubs, and they will be invested in protecting them. So that's one of the few reasons why she might decide to move them. And then, of course, it's just parasite buildup. Been distracted by trying to keep track of what is going on. So let us, when we do have the opportunity, we will get a chance to see his face properly. I could be totally wrong. It might be a different male entirely, which would make a little bit more sense, because then he's probably been putting in the hard work courting another female of the Nkuhuma pride. The scars, well, I mean, they're all a little bit scarred these days. But Aqua, I'm not 100%. We might be looking at a different male. It's definitely not number three, I don't think. His tail strip didn't look thin enough. Here's our young lioness. I think this is the... Come, girl, can you look at us for a second? Oh, no. I think this might be the youngest lioness of the Nkuhumas, but I'm not 100% sure. Those of you who are watching and who might have a way of determining whether or not it is, you can let me know if you think I'm wrong or right about that. I also want to know who the second lioness is. I'm very curious to know who she is. Hello. Thank you, girl. No. Don't think so. It's one of the younger lionesses, but I don't think it's the youngest lioness. And there you go. That unique pot... Start again. The unique little spot pattern on her nose. That will change, of course, with time. Most importantly, we're looking at the whisker spot pattern, because that is what remains constant throughout a lion's life. So the way in which its whisker spots are arranged will tell you which lioness we're looking at. Now, those of you with screenshots to hand will be able to compare and contrast and work out which lioness it is. I don't think it's the youngest one. Now, I need to get onto the Game Drive channel and just chat. I know the tax was interested in approaching, but only if they were not going into this terrible block. So let me chat to him quickly.
Well, the point of this is not so much everybody, it's the fact that, it just offers an amazing view from here. Now, off to where I'm pointing is the Balanites tree out of which Brent Leo Smith plummeted during our during our rehearsals a couple of weeks ago. And Taxon found some wild dog tracks heading into this block. Now, that's like a quarter of a mile away, and you know how fast wild dogs move, but they don't seem to have crossed out of this block, so we're just walking around here. It is quite a large block. I can see Herbert over to that side. And the other great reason for being up here, of course, is that the rising sun is on my face, and it's really very pleasant indeed. As David joins me, if your picture suddenly jerks and spins around, it's because David has plummeted from the top of this termite mound or halfway up it. And for showing you my legs in the sun, I am sure it must have been a disturbing sight to see such toothpicks this early in the morning. Now, there's the Balanites tree. It's a most wonderful view. Look at that great big green tree. Can you see, David? It's that very big green tree there. That's the Balanites tree, or the torchwood, after which Balanites Road gets its name. And as Dave pans to the right-hand side, isn't that perfect? And I'm not sure how much ambient sound you're getting, probably very little. But there are a few robins calling behind us, some larks, some hornbills off to the east into the sun. And it is the most wonderful, wonderful atmosphere out here. While we're just enjoying soaking up...
There's a little bit of a complicated choice here. They're splitting up, but they're not going to split up permanently. All that's happening is that the male is blocking the female from going where she wants to go, which is after the second lioness, who, by the way, I've confirmed is Amber Eyes. It's definitely Amber Eyes. The female growling away. She's not impressed with his blocking attempts. Okay, let's go. Let's keep up with them. I don't want to drive through there. Not with Wendy out of commission and only having one vehicle. I don't want to risk Rusty. No doubt these two are going to come out in front of us. There we go. She's going that way, girl. Thank you to Arcadia, who does think that it's the youngest female that this male is courting. You could well be absolutely right, and that we've got number four rather than blonde. And of course, she's only just started reaching sexual maturity. She's only recently come into estrus, and even then we're relatively certain it's false estrus. Oh, shame. You can see how upset she is. Ears back. him blocking her. Terribly impressed with this. Now, this initial courting phase is because she isn't in full estrus yet. She's not ready to mate, but she is about to be. And he is making sure that she stays his and only his for... Oh, so unimpressed. Desperately trying to get around him. Oh! What's she after? Oh, it's a scrub hair. Into scrub hair. And that's one very frightened scrub hair now. It's hiding somewhere in a bush, probably panting and re-evaluating its life choices. Dearie me. Don't. And she's very, very much unimpressed with his attentions. How stunning is this in this light? Absolutely awesome. Ready to mate, where she's of any interest to the males. All she wants to do is stay with the other lioness. A bit closer. Junebug's raised an interesting point, which is, do I think that they are trying to keep... It's entirely possible, you never know with wild animals, but I don't think that that's their intention. I think that they are more than comfortable to allow any of the Birmingham boys near the cubs, and in fact, they won't be able to prevent his protecting her. Absolutely awesome to watch their behavior. All just over the ridge. Let's try and catch up with them. So Junebug, it's a good point that they might be protecting the cubs. Lionesses definitely do that with strange males. They'll act in order to distract them and to stop them from killing cubs. But that's not the case here. Can't see amber eyes anymore. They're making their way straight towards where we were going, which is Gowrie Cutline. That's where we were going to start our search for lions this morning. I've completely lost track of amber eyes. I don't know where she's gone. I do know that she's hungry and that she wants to hunt. And so does this young female. Safari Dean has suggested that perhaps if he caught her some food, maybe bought her dinner first, that she might be more willing to participate in his attentions. And now that he's looked straight at me, it is not the Birmingham boy that we had yesterday. Tax, are you coming from Gowrie Cutline's side? Sorry, guys. Or won't let the other one follow. There's that deep growling again. He just looks a bit confused. And slowly, slowly, meter by meter, she managed to sort of zigzag her way in the direction of the other female. Wow. once again, trying to get across in that direction. Must be terribly frustrating. At which point, she'll be relatively content to settle down with him, but I think that she would quite like to have a meal first, which I definitely don't blame her for. Copy that, that he has got amber eyes on the drainage line. Oh, sorry, not on the drainage line, on the termite mound in front of us, which obviously we can't see right now. I think let us wait here for the moment. She's not going to settle for long. Oh, she's in the tree. Oh, look at that. Okay, hold on, we are going to reposition. She's in a fallen marula tree. To the male and the female in a moment. Taxi, she's just come down. Pity. Oh well, we've got another view of our mating pair. She tries once again. Well, I think that these things are going, this situation is going to play out in a very similar way over the next few hours. Now, there's some exciting news I've just heard on the Game Drive channel, and that is that wild dog tracks have been found. Let's go over to James.
Here are the tracks, everybody, of the wild dogs. Now, to track these things on foot, of course, almost impossible unless you happen to be a marathon runner, and pack it's going to be impossible. But we might be lucky, because they could have killed something around here, and then we might see them. There is the track. Now, it's quite difficult to make out exactly what I'm pointing at here. At the back, there's the back pad, which you can see. So it's just like a domestic dog, and there are four front pads, and they're slightly exploded. So in other words, they're not close together like a hyena track. Hyena track, the pads are right in here. You don't get this ridge that you do around the back pad. So there are the four pads, and there are claw marks round about where I've put my grass stick. Not easy to follow. We're going to just sort of head along the line that they were going, and if they've happened to kill something on the way, then we'll come across them. Now, wild dogs on foot are not a danger to human beings. They're a real joy to watch on foot, and normally if you can find wild dogs on foot and you sit down, they'll come and investigate you, and it's quite fun. In fact, it's exceptional fun, and it's a real kind of connection with something very wild. And so that's what we'll do. We'll head along here, but like I say, to actually track them on foot, well, I mean, it would be almost impossible. Normally what a lion will do, let's pretend that a lion stood up where Herbert is there. If a lion stood up there, for example, most likely they would move off and look back, and they get up and they move off and they look like that, and then they carry on going, and if you back off, then they'll lie down again. Sometimes, if their blood is up, if they're angry at something, if they're tense, still, they'll stop sometimes very close by, and it can be absolutely, well, it is possibly the most terrifying thing in the world, but they will stand. And interestingly, the lions you're looking at now, I think there's a bit of tension there. And so if I was to come across them on foot, they would most likely run, but you might get a little bit of an aggressive response. And remember, when I use the term aggression, I mean that they are feeling tense, they are likely to be easily threatened, and therefore to respond in a slightly aggressive fashion. They are not inherently aggressive. Lions are not inherently aggressive animals. The only inherently aggressive animal out here, David, is?
Human
beings, correct. We're not going to, like I say, I mean, to actually track these things on foot, you're going to be running. But we might be lucky, because they have driven the road down to the south of us there. There is a road, and they've driven it, and they haven't had the tracks there. Now, Shamsun, you ask a very, very, very good question. You say, are the spiritual healers, the sangomas, the doctors, able to collect medicinal plants from the reserve? And the answer is largely no, they're not. And it's been the source of some contention. And of course, one of the major issues of South Africa is what we call land reform. And I mean, we could talk about this for hours, but most of you would go to sleep. Reform is a major issue out here because, of course, with our history, most black people were dispossessed of the land that they lived on. And a lot of that land was this conservation land that we're standing on now. And so it is contested land. It's contested. These are contested spaces. All conservation land throughout Africa is often contested spaces. And one of the reasons for that is that traditional healers can't come in and collect the plants that they want. There are some very progressive landowners in various parts that do allow people on to harvest and collect medicinal plants, and certainly that goes a long way to helping us protect these natural areas. But it's a really good question, and it's a source of some conflict, shall we say, in various parts of Africa. I think various parts of the world live on and operate on, provide contentious spaces, and that's not always. It's a difficult balance to have, of course, because we know that the human population is far greater than it ever has been in our history, and therefore we have to protect land. But the unfairness of it here, especially in the African context, would have an almost negligible effect on the wildlife. And it was only with the advent of European settlers and their guns and their voracious appetites for ivory and hides that we had the problem that conservation became a necessity at all. So it's worth bearing that in mind as we wander through here. Chamsung, very nice. He's over here. We'll just see if he's got the tracks there. Hello, Michael. You say, how long does it take to learn Shangan? It depends entirely on what your home language is. I'll get Chitwa Hoffman. Okay, so they've crossed south, these dogs. They've gone across the reserve, right across here, and onto the reserve to the south of us. Should we just head to Treehouse Dam, maybe? Yeah. Well, on what you learn as your first language. So if your first language happens to be isiZulu, for example, then you'll learn Shangaan very quickly. If it happens to be any of what we call the Bantu languages here, like Sotho, Venda, not so much Venda, but Sotho, certainly you'll pick up Shangaan quite quickly. But if your language is a Western language, like Afrikaans or English, then you're going to struggle. The structure of the language is completely unfamiliar, and the way you put things together is unfamiliar. So I can speak it passably in a conversational fashion. Bad luck there, Davy. So I can speak it conversationally, and to a white, and I mean, the trick eventually is to be able to fool a Shangaan into believing that they're talking to a Shangaan, and I'm a long way from that. And as a youngster, you learn it pretty quickly, and I mean, for example, the managers here, Mike Grover and his wife Candace, their little girl speaks Shangaan fluently, completely fluently. You'd never know that you were talking to a white girl if you heard her speaking. You can do it. Let's say if you put real effort into it, you can become conversational in, say, 6 months to a year. All right, let's go back to Jamie, find out what her update is. We'll carry on down towards Treehouse Dam.
We've arrived at a very perfect time to Buffalsuk Dam. Now, why have I left the lions, you may wonder? Well, it's because this week is a week full of surprises, and I have my reasons. I have very exciting reasons for having left the lions behind. Let's just stop for one moment and watch our elephants mill about and possibly come down to drink, because I'm waiting for any more than that. Just know that this is most definitely a week full of very pleasant moments. It's okay, Elise. They came racing down this way, and then all of a sudden everybody stopped before approaching the dam. Perhaps a smell. It's not us. It's definitely not us. but perhaps something came to drink earlier that was a bit smelly, and that they are a little bit concerned about, because they're not racing down to the water as they might usually be. Come on, guys, it's okay. And something's definitely made them anxious, clustering together a little bit. Perhaps they've just decided that's where they want to rest. Maybe it's not nerves at all, because it looks as though at the back some of the little ones might be settling down. Perhaps for a bit of a nap in the shade before they go down to drink. Hello, little one. What a wonderful way to continue our sunrise safari. It just gets better and better. There's little one keeping up with the rest of the herd. I always feel for them a little bit. They've got to trot when an elephant herd starts to walk rapidly. Keep up with all of those long legs. To pull out, but no rush at all. Copy that, thank you. Oh, there we go. Racing down to the water's edge. Oh, so excited, so excited. Now, Shamsun, you were wondering if there's the possibility of a crocodile that's perhaps got them quite so anxious when they're clearly very thirsty. Oh, run, 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 thirsty, 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 oh, thirsty, 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 wait for me. The elephant water walk, as Brent describes it, everybody pushing forward to a place there. Shamsun, it's always possible there's a crocodile around and about. I don't think there is in this case, but they never know for certain, and certainly you never ever take a waterhole for granted out here, even as a human being. Oh, their agility is just incredible. Thirsty, 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 thirsty. Oh, marvelous. A whole ring of elephants around Buffalo's Hook Dam. What a stunning view. Oh! Copy, Orbs, I'm on my way. Guys, I'm really sorry. We have to leave this incredible scene. Now, you know me and you know my love for elephants, and you know that I wouldn't, under any circumstances, leave such a special scene that we're watching, but I really do have a special surprise up my sleeve, so we do have to go. All right, little one, it's okay. I'm sorry, it's beautiful, it's absolutely stunning. I would love to stay, except that what I've got. Hello, elephant, can I come past? No, fair enough. Well, I mean, if elephant says we can't go, then we can't go. Let's just wait for it to meander down. So while we move across towards Aubrey, let's go over to James, and hopefully when I get back to you, I will have...
And you don't. But soon you'll be enjoying it, and I will not. Here is one of the last sort of succulent bits of flower, and it's a Waltheria, and many of you have seen these Waltherias before, and I stopped here because there have been so many spiders and other little interesting things that Steph has found on them, but I think all of those things are finished now, you know. I think they're all done. And that's the flowering we've got here, are two spiders. And I don't know... I don't know if the actual spiders, their little nests of silk are tiny, tiny, tiny Probably, I mean, that's they're less than, they're sort of half a centimeter long each in diameter. And I can actually see a very, very, very tiny spider in there that you're not going to be able to see. If we had the microscope, we could show it to you. But we don't have that out here. And the spider itself is probably about half a millimeter, a tenth of a millimeter. It is tiny, tiny, tiny. I can't believe that. I can't even point it out to you, it's so small. And it could be the... Anyway, all over here, all over this bush, we've got these little spiders and things trying to get through the winter, eking out a living, some of them going dormant, some of them not, and some of them sort of trying to cope with the fact that there's no insect for them to eat, except ants. And very few... this spider will probably be largely an ant eater, actually, because the ants will climb up the stalk here, they'll knock about on the inflorescence and try and the silk. Tony, you're in London and you say my legs look inviting. Thank you, Tony. It's very kind of you. No one's ever said that about my legs before, Tony. You weren't obviously saying it in that context at all. You say how often do we come across snakes out here? And because my legs look inviting. Tony, it's actually fine that what they do is they will hear you walking. So we walk along the ground like this, and it gives off a certain amount of vibration, especially if you're wearing boots the size of the ones that David's wearing and carrying a pack. And snakes then move away from us because they don't like to see us. We're a threat to them. The snake that you're most likely to come across that is a threat to a human being on foot is a puff adder, which you're going to fall over. What they do is they seldom move away, and so it's quite difficult. Sometimes, you know, you can be walking along and you'll just stand on one. And if you stand on it, then it will bite you, and they bite very quickly. It's very unlikely that you're going to be bitten, but they can bite very quickly. And then I suppose, yeah, look, these boots are not going to be much help against a snake, and I might get a nip on the ankle, and that will be very painful. Apparently it's like being run over by a truck, the pain. And then you'd have to get to hospital quite quickly. But it's so unlikely it's much more likely that I... Nevin, what a very, very good question you ask. You say, if an animal like a snake has to shed its skin, but it's a vertebrate and it doesn't have an exoskeleton, kind of what's the difference between that and a scorpion that has to keep shedding? It has to shed its skin, I suppose, because it grows in segments, it grows in scales. And what you need to think about, or maybe consider, is when something grows in sections, and those sections are quite big, it's very difficult for them to grow simultaneously. If you've got, you have to have lots and lots of different growth points for those segments to grow at exactly the same rate, and so that everything fits neatly into each other. You know, the snake can then harden. And that doesn't harden, but it becomes. I suppose it just becomes slightly harder over a snake. But a snake's skin is not an exoskeleton. It doesn't give the snake firmness at all. It's just a protection from the sun and from the elements. Also, the other thing to remember is that with us, we're shedding our skin continuously. We're shedding the cells of our skin continuously. And a snake doesn't do that. A reptile doesn't do that. It's always to do with size that a reptile changes skin. Right. Everybody, it is with great pain in my heart and great jealousy that I must hand you over to Jamie and the surprise.
Hello, everybody. On our live safari, I would like to introduce you to three identical little lion cubs and their mom. Our new members of the Nkuhuma Pride. They've been hiding out on Torchwood. We've been patiently waiting for them to appear. After months and months of the sort of chaos in the lion dynamics
and watching the tragedies of the Nkuhuma pride unfold. To see these three little faces staring across at us, well, it just doesn't get better than this, does it, Brian?
Nope.
And I'm so glad that we could share this moment with all of you. At about 5 weeks of age, still with their little spots. Somebody's gone to sleep. Imagine that you are all as thrilled and excited as we are. Oh, breakfast time. Oh no, whoopsie. Sliding off Mum. And that is why we had to leave the other end. A little bit about my excitement. Oh, these two ones are so dozy. They're falling asleep sitting up. Ah, this is just too precious. Almost, when you're only 5 weeks old. Look at how spotted they still are. Whoops! Almost. Come on, up you get. I'm sorry, I'm doing that thing I do when I see young cubs where I forget how to talk and I just giggle incoherently. But they're incredible. This is absolutely incredible. Well done, clever girl. Hey? Here we go, the lioness that we knew had cubs. Oh! And what a brood it is. The first time we are properly seeing lion cubs from the Nkuhuma pride in a very long time. And this is what makes safari life so incredibly special. When we can follow a story from the end of one chapter to the beginning of the next. I hope you've all got your screenshot fingers working hard, because this clawing its way over Mum. This constant playfulness we were talking about and eagerly anticipating. Oopsie! We have been looking forward to this moment for so long. Mum. I make life a bit more tricky. Oh, what an absolute pleasure this has been. And guys, it just goes to show you, for those of you who are concerned about the den site itself and our impact on them, they are not this is so cool. This is awesome. The last time I saw lion cubs playing like this on Juma was a year ago with the Styx cubs. So I think actually our view might be improved now that they're behind the bush by feet in the air, by going backwards a bit. But let's just settle here for now. Even if it is through the trees, we can still get an idea of what their little mischiefs are up to. Using Mom as a jungle gym. Battering each other. And this is what we were talking about, that sort of constant play that lion cubs do with each other. It's got its tail. It's pulling it backwards by its tail. Wow. This isn't where I... Well, it is actually what we were planning for the morning. I just didn't expect it to actually happen quite so easily. And we have a huge thank you to say to Aubrey, by the way. You found them for us and called us in. On an adventure. And the best part of this is, too, watching playful cubs tumbling over each other. At least one of the other Nkulumo lionesses is pregnant or has given birth recently. And over the next few weeks, we'll see the cubs coming together with the rest of the pride. And I couldn't be more excited about it. And hopefully the Birmingham boys remain the dominant males in this area and we get to watch these cubs. Okay. There is another vehicle on its way. Because they are in a very easily accessible area, so we haven't gone off-road at all to reach them. So what they are doing is they're opening it up as decision from the head guides. They're opening it up to two vehicles. Provided that there's only obviously one engine on at a time and that we keep the distance that we currently have. Playfulness, developing the skills that they are going to need for the rest of their adult lives. They're very fortunate to have siblings to practice with. Guys, I do just need to have a quick chat to Tax, who is in the other vehicle. I just want to know if he wants to... Whoopsie! I just want to reach over and chat to him. Okay guys, I'm just going to move slightly. I'm actually going to let Tax and his guests go ahead because we have had the most incredible view. So just hold on one moment. He's moving back so that I can move as well. We're just going to do some shuffling around. Hold on, let's see what Tax is going to do. Our page, while we do some repositioning and some shuffling around, wanted to know if we know the sex of the cubs, and the answer is no, we don't. We won't know for a little while yet. It's very difficult to see. Tax, you guys go ahead. Okay. Since we have these guys to thank for our sighting, and it only stands to reason that we let them go a little bit ahead. So Paige, it's really, really difficult to tell the difference between a male and a female cub at this point, particularly with the view that we've had. We will get to observe them over the next few weeks and we will be able to tell. Their testicles haven't descended yet, if there are any males in that group, so it won't be immediately obvious. We'll have to wait and see exactly what the final outcome is in terms of males, females. What we're really hoping for, to be completely honest, is in terms of supplementing the Nkulumo Pride's numbers, is females that will stay with the rest of the pride for the rest of their lives. Of course, a young male is equally welcome, but I would very much like to see the Nkulumo Pride go. Let's stop here for now. Let's go forward a little bit for now so that Brian's got a view of the cub at the back. We will have a chance to spend more time with them in a moment.
Obviously, there are other people that want to get in and enjoy this sighting. Aqua, I haven't heard them making their adorable little squeals yet, but I have no doubt that they will at some point in the next few moments. Ow! Ow! Sound. Don't want to make it too loudly, because obviously I don't want to distract them or impact them in any way. It seems as though it might be time to settle down for now. Have a little bit of rest, in the sand after all of that playing. Watches on indulgently. Aretas, you're saying that these are your first lion cubs and that they have stolen your heart. Well, I don't think you're alone. I think that I'm so glad that we could bring this to all of you. You know, really, you can't help but fall in love with them. Oh, yummy. A little bit of elephant dung first thing in the morning. How awesome is that? Look what I found. I want it. I want that dung. Really. Absolutely incredible. Yes, absolutely. While we watch our lion cubs play and we compare them to our leopards are destined to be solitary versus the lions, which are destined to be social cats. And who knows what lies in these cubs' futures. Imagine if it's a group of three males with, you know, I can't help it. This is just too awesome for words. Guys, I just need to get onto the Game Drive channel. As I said, there are lots of people that would like to enjoy this moment. And as you can see, it's having no impact on the behavior of the cubs or the mom. Henry for Jamie. You are on standby one. Copy that. Tax is here. It is a two-vehicle lock because it's nice and open. If you want to make your way, just let me know when you're close and I'll pull out. Copy that, no problem. Oh, this is so incredible. It really, really doesn't get better than this. There we go, Aqua. They are making a noise. They are making their little cub calls very, very faintly. I just heard one now. Oh! Poor mom. Isn't she so incredibly patient with them? Those teeth are sharp. Lisa, while we watch them, you wanted to know what their chances of survival are, which is, of course, the question on everybody's mind. Because around up sort of their first year, the cubs' chances, whether they're males or females, are exactly the same. And depending on the area, the other lion concentration, on a number of circumstances, you're probably looking at an average of about 40 to 50% mortality. After that, after about a year old, if the cub is a male, things change dramatically because, of course, then at some point in the next year and a half of their life, they're going to have to go off on their email. I've got my tongue back. The bush is full of toys, if you know where to look. This is so cool. this age, they couldn't be more cat-like if they tried. That's so awesome. Now, we've got to hope that in terms of the survival chances of these cubs, if the Birmingham boys stay in power, then their chances of survival are much, much higher than they would be if another male. I wonder, she was desperate for a break the other day. Just constant nipping teeth and scratching claws. And of course, that does then beg the question, do lion moms leave their cubs alone for more or less time than leopards leave their cubs? Leave their cubs for slightly less time, but I don't think there's a huge amount of difference. Pounce. Oh, all over Mom's face. You see what we mean about lion cubs playing? It's just nipping teeth and waving paws. And any movement is pounced upon. You know, I think James might be right. I think lion cubs might actually be the cutest bit. There we go. I've got my dung ball. I've hunted a dung ball and I've caught it. Oh, but actually, whatever my siblings might be doing might not more interesting. Tail. One's got a pile of elephant dung, the other one's got Mom's tail. Now, of course, you and Margaret in Kansas, with pleasure, I can give you a size approximation, although she's doing it beautifully, oopsie, for you. Where's Mom going, guys? Are you going with her? Definitely not going to be bashing through. This is such a perfect cub spot. Look how beautiful it is. So many sandy places and crevices where she can hide her cubs. Absolutely awesome. So a size approximation, sorry, yes. Not yay big. So they're shorter than a house cat in terms of size. They're probably bulkier. They're stockier. But your average house